public health issues become politically charged, like wearing a mask or not becomes a political statement. You cannot imagine how destructive that is to any unified public health message.
I completely agree. Wearing a mask is not political. It's responsible. Also, I break out all the time and a mask covers it. It's a win-win.
Women in particular have been badly affected by job losses and extra burdens of care. We also see fragility in the climate and biodiversity crisis. Those are existential threats, and those are getting worse. We are waging war on nature and destroying our life support system, and nature is striking back.
Obviously, Mother Nature is striking back. If my Indian mom has taught me anything, it's that a mother will put you in your place. So check out my girl Greta, tell it like it is.
Today, we hear nations and leaders all over the world speak of an existential climate emergency. And yet, instead of taking the immediate action you would in any emergency, they set up vague, hypothetical, distant targets way into the future. Targets based on loopholes and incomplete numbers. Targets like net zero emissions 2050. Targets that equal surrender.
Every time I lose faith in humanity, I look at people like Greta and my faith gets restored. Thankfully, Greta's not alone and things don't have to stay this way.
There is a very strong awareness by people that climate change is an issue that must be dealt with as a matter of priority. More than 70% in 16 largest countries want climate change and the fight against it to be the priority.
Unions already knew the crisis we faced before the pandemic hit. The climate emergency, historical levels of inequality driving exclusion, anger and despair. And COVID-19 laid that bare. So we've got choices now. Will people be at the forefront with their environment of a new social contract, or will we see business as usual? So this week is very important.
She's got my vote. If ever it needed saying, twice. I'm gonna be real with you. If you're like me, sometimes hearing all this stuff can feel overwhelming and you don't know what to do, but the thing is, if we come together, we can all do something. It's so important now more than ever to pay attention and to act.
Oxfam is at Davos, as you say, this year with new data. It shows that we risk facing the greatest rise in inequality since records began. And it could take more than a decade for billions of people to recover from the economic hit of the pandemic. While at the very top, just 10 billionaires, all men, have seen their wealth skyrocket by $500 trillion since March. That could have paid to vaccinate the world and prevent anyone from being pushed into poverty by the pandemic.
We need to ensure these kind of technological benefits help us all. And the development of a COVID vaccine is just another example.
It is a moral duty to treat the vaccine as a global public good that ensures that low-income and poor countries are not left at the end of the waiting line as high-income countries buy the majority of the most promising vaccines.
Thankfully, Gavi has been working to make sure that it's not just the rich who see the benefits of this vaccine.
We ended up with 190 countries coming together to work together on this, which shows the importance of solidarity because we're only safe if everyone is safe.
And it's about time that we all put the same energy into stopping climate change.
The pandemic, of course, is taking a terrible toll on lives and livelihoods and against the backdrop of the climate crisis. So we do need to move to a phase of healing people and the planet so that we come out of this on the right side of history.
The whole world has to come to this table to solve the problem. We rejoin the international climate effort with humility and ambition. Humility because we know we've wasted 4 years in which we were inexcusably absent.
And not just these issues, we also have to be very conscious about racial, religious, and sexual discrimination.
We must recognize that the challenge of white supremacy is real. Patriarchy is real in our capitalist systems. And if we want a more just recovery, we have to acknowledge that before coronavirus, there was a world. That world is over.
That was just the tip of the iceberg. So if you want to hear more about how the world's changing from the people in the driving seat, then check out the website and subscribe to the channel. There's hours of discussions, highlights, and more at your fingertips.
And in case you're wondering how Bhuvan and I fit in, it's because these issues impact all of us, and it's important that we use our platforms to reach as many people as possible. So please spread the word.
There are vaccine doses in vials now, and we're hoping to have something like 145 to 150 million doses delivered in the first quarter, maybe 500 million in the second quarter, and then 1.5 billion in the second half of the year.
There are still pitfalls related to equity and access, as these comments from Cyril Ramaphosa show.
Rich countries in the world are holding on to these vaccines. And we are saying, release the excess vaccines that you have ordered and hoarded. The world needs access to those vaccines.
But it's integral that wealthy countries don't just act independently, which is why I'm pleased to let you hear firsthand from some European heavyweights.
If we don't urgently act to protect our nature, the next pandemic will be around the corner. To those who prefer the business case, here it is. More than half of global GDP is dependent on high-functioning biodiversity and ecosystems. The top five global risks are all related to the environment.
If we're going to see success and growth in the future, we'll need to first agree on how we treat and take care of our planet.
Our societies are vulnerable because nature is reminding us of this. We are vulnerable to pandemic, climatic events, and so on. And so the economy of tomorrow, strengthened by these lessons, is going to have to be an economy that thinks about innovation and humanity. And it's going to have to build competitiveness together with the climate challenge, reducing CO2 emissions, adapting our societies, the biodiversity agenda. So it's an economy that will have to be more resilient.
And I could not share one of my favorite highlights from the session on reimagining education with Professor Angela Duckworth.
Most of us did not grow up with Google, right? Or like the internet, but like that now exists. Like, why would you want to memorize almost anything? There is a kind of Byzantine structure in education that we've inherited from, you know, the way civilization just was for a long time. And now, because knowledge has expanded exponentially and access to it has become frictionless and immediate, like, why do we still school in the same way?
As an educator myself, I agree with Professor Duckworth's points. Why are we doing school the exact same way it was done years ago, when the way that students engage with the world and the ways that they learn are constantly evolving and changing? We need to be preparing students for the challenges of the future, and in order to do that, we need innovative approaches to teaching to be integrated into the classroom.